What really struck me about The Queen's Gambit was that it wasn't at all about chess. It's not about a game, it's about the cost of genius.
It's a story about how you survive in a world when you have a very specific gift that makes you harder to understand.
I think she looks to chess as very much an escape.
Although it tells that story about a child genius working up to a world level, it's actually still more about her demons.
Right, I can still do. Can I still move another piece?
No, it's touchable.
Scott sent me the book to read before I met him, and I devoured the book in about an hour. I fell in love with Beth immediately, and there was a really strong kinship.
This character is, you know, essentially her own antagonist, and I was fascinated. I'd never read a character like this before. Somebody who was so brilliant and so self-destructive, and in a world that she was already kind of not a part of.
Are you sure you want to do this?
I'm sure.
We don't have a women's section.
Back in the 1950s, there were very few females turning to chess. We weren't given the opportunities. Beth trying to make her way in a male-dominated discipline and world is something that's quite distinctive and unusual.
Tevis was writing with an understanding of the next century, almost. It's quite brilliant.
How old are you? Never mind. Don't answer that. It'll just depress me.
Well, I'm 36.
She's so centered in how intelligent she is that she doesn't necessarily think of herself as a woman first. And I do think that there's something to that because you're experiencing the 60s through her in the way that she just automatically assumes that she is equal.
Am I good enough now?
To tell you the truth of a child, you're astounding.
Mocha.
And action.
Almost 10 years ago, Bill Horberg had brought up the book to me as something that I might want to do. We briefly flirted with doing it as a feature, and Alan Scott had written quite a nice script, and nothing ever came of it. It was very hard to get a movie like that made at the time. Then, right after I finished Godless, I had this revelation, and I said to him, what about The Queen's Gambit as a miniseries?
The overriding interest I've always had is to make it powerfully emotional. And I think when you extend something, you get the time to follow all kinds of paths and all kinds of themes.
What I really wanted to focus on and the challenge in turning it into a miniseries for me was making sure that what you're really invested in is her.
Someday you're going to be all alone. So you need to figure out how to take care of yourself.
She's come from a home life and just a lot in life that has left her feeling very unstable. She doesn't really know where she's going to end up.
What's that game called?
It's called chess.
Will you teach me?
I think Beth's first true connection is with Mr. Scheibel. It's with somebody who she feels understands not only her gift, but how her brain works. Also somebody who can tell her no.
You have resigned the game.
You didn't tell me that in the rules.
It's not a rule. It's sportsmanship.
And then I think she's got a wonderful friendship with Jolene, and that comes from a place of both understanding that they're very different and yet have come from the exact same place.
Most of us are lifers. Been here a long time.
I would say she's kind of like a mother to Beth in her own little way. They're not adopted for the majority of their lives, so they kind of do need to depend on each other in that place.
Green's to even your disposition, orange and brown's for building a strong body. Take them both.
In the early 60s, late 50s, it was very common to give children in orphanages tranquilizers to make them easier to handle. So yeah, she becomes addicted to tranquilizers and sedatives when she's 9.
Well, the trick with addiction, with drinking or drugs or anything, is making sure that you empathize with the character and still tell a compelling story. The sleight of hand for me was humor sometimes. There's a long sequence where she steals the pills, and that was as funny as it is harrowing.
Elizabeth!
As she gets older, she forms many addictions. She discovers alcohol when she's about 15.
It's good.
And consummates that relationship.
anybody who's dealing with problems of addiction is their own worst enemy. She keeps self-destructing along the way.
There's a moment when she's been on a particularly tough bender, and she meets the first person that she ever played, who's another girl called Annette Packer.
I knew you were going places, and that meant something to me.
That whole exchange was really, really tricky and rough to do because I just had to be in this state of everything is falling apart and you looked up to me and now I have to carry that shame. Like, she was an angry bird.
I'm worried about you.
What on earth for?
For me, the whole story is organized around that. Is she going to lose hold of herself or is she going to be able to make it?
She shows the assurance of a player twice her age. That's national recognition, dear.
She's also addicted to winning. She's addicted to feeling like she is in control.
Chess is the one thing she feels like she can control. That on that board, she's in charge. Whenever she's moving those pieces around, she's at home.
Owen,
I have every confidence.
You do feel for the relationship that both Mrs. Wheatley and Beth have together. And Mari played her with deep empathy and I think sympathy.
For the role of Mrs. Wheatley, I had been telling Bill Horberg that it's someone like Marielle Heller. And Bill said to me, why don't you just cast her? And as you can see, she's extraordinary.
Things are beginning to happen.
Beth is very obsessive. Full stop. Like, I think that is just something that is intrinsic to her.
Harry, it'll be check once the pawn moves and the knight trades. Can't you see that?
No, I can't. I can't find it that fast.
Well, wish you could.
When your brain works that quickly, it can drive you a bit mad. But I also think that she is aware that her gift makes her special.
Sometimes people find patterns or meaning where there aren't any.
What does that have to do with me?
Well, creativity and psychosis often go hand in hand.
I do think she's like consistently worried that she's a bit crazy.
Beth has visions of seeing a chessboard on the ceiling.
This is in the book. She looks up to the ceiling and imagines the position and the places of the pieces.
Do you ever go over games in your head? I mean, play all the way through them?
Doesn't everybody?
The person that she feels closest to, I think, in terms of the way that her brain works is actually Benny.
There is a little bit of a reflection in each other, even though they're, you know, vastly different people. But I think he enjoys getting into mind games and into other people's heads, and he sees that in Beth.
I don't even know if I'm good enough.
You're the best there is.
His reassurance kind of makes her feel a bit more calm, but I do think that she's juggling a very fine line of, like, am I insane or am I a genius?
I've been watching your games. You attack like Alucard.
You can reach for your best, but it only really matters if other people see it as well. And I think Benny appreciates Beth's talent when he sees it and finds that attractive from the get-go.
And action.
To make chess cinematic is impossible. And I realized I want the chess that we do show to be accurate enough, but I really I'm focusing on the stakes around the games and the players themselves, Beth Harmon in particular, and the idea for me visually was to get inside her.
I found that the strongest points is just being on people's faces and their reaction. Even if you don't understand chess, you know the seriousness and the drama that they're going through.
I resign.
Stephen Meisler is quite good at shaping just very little light and very natural light and finding little spots that create its own drama.
Sweet dreams.
The show really shifts along with Beth's perspective. Every time I got to go onto a new set, I was always completely blown away by the way that it looked.
Uli Hanusch is a genius. I came to Berlin because I wanted to work with him. But we've shot Mexico City here, and Las Vegas, and Paris, Russia, pieces of New York, and Lexington, Kentucky.
Well, now.
What Beth does is traveling and playing chess at tournaments. And so we have, like, hotel rooms, airplanes, hotel lobbies, restaurants, ballroom kind of situation for each tournament. So it was our target To repeat.
To make it different.
Yeah, exactly.
I asked for a pleasant room, and I believe they gave me one.
here is a pretty special location in Berlin. It's the House Cumberland, and we turn it into a hotel in Paris.
What will you have then for your one drink? Must be special if it is your only one.
Cut. Awesome.
That's a cut.
For me, every set I would walk on would be a fantastic place to shoot. And the whole crew would come on the set, and you would hear 50 people, 100 people oohing and aahing about these locations. Benny's apartment was interesting because we shot the exterior in Toronto. And then Uli designed this basement apartment that was amazing. And right away, I started changing the scene because of so many good things in the set.
I love it. Oh, it's so good. Yeah.
The cinematography, the costumes, the production design, they're all, for me, part of the same thing. We spend a lot of time talking about where Beth is at in the story.
We had so much fun coming up with the look for this because, again, we got to grow up with Beth.
When I first read the script, I had in my mind that Beth was a redhead. Funny enough, Anya also felt this.
When I first read it, I was like, she needs to have red hair because I want her to be completely identifiable, even if she doesn't want to be. And he had thought the exact same thing. So we just started off on a really good foot. It was all wigs. I was very happy to dye my hair, but I just couldn't, you know, there are days when we were going between 5 different ages in a day, and that's just not possible with your own hair. So we had baby Beth, we had sexy kitten, and we had glamour puss.
To sell the age, the younger, the less makeup, and then you slowly add very, very small adjustments until you start seeing her older, and she basically gets more of these eyelashes, so her eyes become sexier.
Wow.
Thanks. Beth has a thing for flair. As you can see in the show, she likes the finer things in life. She starts to really, really like clothes.
With the costume designer, with Gabriella, her wardrobe is just amazing. She would have a palette book and all of the dresses and the different wardrobe that Beth would be wearing. But more than that, we'd spend a lot of time talking about where Beth is at in the story.
In the beginning, Beth is always determined by other people, by her mother or dresses in the orphanage. And later on, she is alone and she discovers more of her body. She has power being feminine.
As we go forward, you know, she's more and more glamorous. There's a point where she dresses up like a pop musician that she sees on TV for a brief period of time.
She experienced that searching for cool is difficult because the cool doesn't exist, and her search for cool is actually her search for herself.
At the very end, when she's kind of finally comfortable in the world of chess, Gabriella found this beautiful long white coat with this white hat for Moscow, and you realize she looks like the White Queen.
What's fascinating about watching her grow up is that she puts on all of these different personas.
Who the hell are you?
It is incredibly sad because it's basically just saying that she just doesn't feel like she's enough without them.
You are very beautiful.
I don't see myself that way.
And you are blind.
It's not a physical loneliness that she's suffering from. It's an emotional and intellectual one.
I think this is the reason why the miniseries is becoming more prominent, because you can explore these richer, more complex stories.
Having the opportunity to spend time with Beth in this way and not just see all of the wins, but all of the hard work, the sacrifices that it takes to get to the wins. I think hopefully that just builds a lot of empathy for somebody who I selfishly really, really care about.